Hello and welcome back to the next episode of next.
No, welcome to the next episode. The welcome episode. To the future.
This is the third LifeXtenShow trivia.
Yep.
And this time it's my turn to punish Nicola for the mean questions that he made me answer. So.
All right, I'm ready.
Now you need to know first that Nicola. He's a mathematician, but he's recently studying chemistry and biology.
Yeah,
right?
It started like a year and a half ago.
Oh, maybe. Yeah, right. Yeah, relatively recently, academically speaking, recently. So he's trying to move into the field of biology. And so...
Not moving, I'm integrating.
Integrating biology in his knowledge. So today, we're going to test his knowledge on... human biology fun facts.
All right.
It's gonna be my revenge. According to the endosymbiotic theory, you want me to spell that for you? All right. Which of the following organelles was originally a primitive bacterial cell? You know already?
Well, go ahead. Let's see what the
that
options are.
That got internalized into a bigger cell, establishing a symbiotic relationship with it. You know it. Don't tell me you know it. I have an extra one. I have a spare question if you know it already.
Well,
I mean, this is the point. If you know it, you know
it. I might be surprised.
All right, okay. Answer one, A. Answer A, one. Answer one, A.
A.
Answer A, lysosome.
Yeah.
Answer B, mitochondria.
Mm-hmm.
Answer C, Golgi apparatus. Answer D, the nucleus. Can you see the...
No, I can't. But for this one, I really don't need to see it because...
Okay, go on.
A was lysosome, B, mitochondria, C, Golgi apparatus, and D was the nucleus.
Yes.
I don't think the nucleus is an organelle.
Okay. Well, all right.
As far as I know, mitochondria are used. Well, the theory goes that they are bacteria that kind of were originally kind of eaten by the cell, by some cells, and that.
Oh, you got it correct. Fine, got it. Thank you. It's correct. Next question.
All right. Okay.
What happens if you put a human erythrocyte into clean water at 37 degrees?
What the is an erythrocyte? Well, I remember
red blood cells.
All right.
A, absolutely nothing.
At least it gets wet.
That's a fair point. That's a fair point. B, it shrinks. C, it bursts. D, it duplicates.
A red blood cell in water at 37
clean
degrees.
Water clean at 37 water. 37 degrees Celsius.
Okay, I'm puzzled about the 37 degree requirements because that's pretty much the temperature you have when you have a fever. So that can't be a coincidence. So I wonder what happens when you have a fever, basically, to your red blood cells.
I'll give you this though. In the laboratory, at least, we consider 37 degrees the standard physiological.
It's not mine, I can tell
Fair
you.
Fair enough, but okay, I'll give you this hint. 37 degrees is usually what in biology research is considered the optimal temperature for physiology.
For humans as well?
Mammals in general, yes.
If it is enough, I mean, if it is like the optimal temperature, I don't see why it should shrink, because otherwise they would just shrink all the time and that they can't shrink forever, so I would exclude that. Then the other is like it bursts and it duplicates.
And absolutely nothing.
Well, of course, it wouldn't burst because, you know, optimal temperature, then your blood cells would burst at optimal temperature. That's not very optimal, I think. It replicates. I'm tempted between absolutely nothing and it replicates because it doesn't feel completely stupid to me that under normal circumstances your blood cells reproduce.
So what's your answer?
I'm going to go with absolutely nothing.
Is that your answer?
That's what I said.
It's correct. Wrong.
Wrong?
It's wrong.
What happens?
You see, you were focusing on the wrong detail.
All right.
37 degrees is great for cells. Clean water, it's not. Cells into clean water, they burst because of the wrong osmolarity.
Oh,
cells
right.
Cells are usually into solutions with specific amounts of salts.
That's a
so
good
if you
point.
Put them into clean water, for osmosis, the water will go inside the cells.
That's a good point.
Burst.
That's a good point.
Which of the following is not a protein? A. Sonic Hedgehog. B. Smaug. C.
Super Mario.
C-3PO.
Oh, fuck.
D. Dumbledore. Now, I know this, there's no reason why you should know this. It was just, I thought it was
no,
a fun.
I mean, like...
And it's a fun question. If you get it, fine.
I mean, like, when you do science, one of the funny things is that the most entertaining thing is that you get to name things.
Exactly. And only one of these is not actually protein.
So Sonic Hedgehog is definite. Wait a moment. So, yeah, it is a protein, and there is a gene called that.
Wow.
And okay. So there is a protein because they have the same name.
Not always, but okay.
Well, generally. Yeah. They write names.
I'm impressed.
They write proteins in italics, whereas the genes.
Oh, are... this guy is studying really hard.
Okay, I'm gonna say that probably. I have a feeling that it is the Star Wars dude, that is like the wrong one.
You confirm that this is your answer?
Yeah.
Wrong. Dumbledore is a great wizard, but not a protein. If I say chromosome, everyone would think of the usual weird-looking sausages attached together, forming an X-shaped structure.
All right.
But in reality, when does the DNA acquire this form? A. During the M phase, during the mitosis, the cell duplication. B. Never. It happens only in movies. C. During the DNA replication. D. During the S phase, where S stands for sausage-shaped DNA.
I feel that this is the...
We have talked about this.
I know, but this is like... The last one seems to be like the... fake option here.
Really? We've seen three proteins called Sonic Hedgehog, Smaug, and C-3PO. Are you surprised?
Well, that's a fair point, but I'm going to say that it happens through replication. What option was
there
that?
There are DNA replication or cell replication. There are A, during the M phase, mitosis, so cell replication, or C, during the DNA replication.
Well, if cells replicate, the DNA has to have... duplicated first, what is the cell going to do without a copy of the DNA? So I would say that it...
That implies that the X-shaped indicates the duplication. Are you sure about that?
No, I'm kind of beginning to doubt because I'm thinking, well, maybe like if when it is in an X shape, it is about to split with the whole cell. So like one half goes to the new cell and one half goes to the original cell, so to speak, even though they both are the original cell in a way. So I am divided. Got the joke? I'm divided. I would say either DNA replication or cell replication. And
you don't like that? You don't like the S as sausage?
No, I don't like the sausage thing. But I'm gonna go with my original intuition when DNA. No, am I that? Okay, fine. With DNA replication, fine.
During DNA replication?
Yeah, come on, hurt me.
You were going well. You were in the M phase when the cell replicates. I want to make this clear. I made this question just because I knew that we talked about this. Because the X-shaped it has the purpose of actually organizing the DNA in such a way that it's easy then to segregate during the cell replication.
I almost got there. I mean, yeah. I remember that we talked about this before. I just didn't remember the details. But I got almost there. You have to give me that.
This is from the 2013 review, The Hallmarks of Aging.
Oh, if I screw this one up, I'm going to be fired.
So, altered intercellular communication is one of the 9 hallmarks of aging, as stated in a cell review from 2013, The Hallmarks of Aging.
Yeah.
Link in description if you're interested. Which of the following compounds has shown to increase the lifespan of mice acting on this specific hallmark?
The one that I mentioned. Never know. All right, fine.
A. Fluoxetine, an antidepressant. B. Aspirin, an anti-inflammatory. C. Psilocybin, a psychedelic. D. Tetrahydrocannabinol.
And that is a what?
It's a lipid found in plants.
There are too many people laughing in this room. The first option is a drug that you use on rats in the lab, isn't it?
Mice. Yeah, I use that. I work with fluoxetine, yes.
Yeah.
Which is an antidepressant. But I don't work on life extension.
Well, I mean, like aspirin I could consider because anti-inflammatory, one of the problems with aging is that you get chronic inflammation. So that could also, like, I know that aspirin, like, prevents heart attack, might prevent heart attacks. I think the science is a bit divided on that. I'm not entirely sure. Well, my reputation is already lost. Prepare for the next quiz. I'm going to go with aspirin.
Well done. It's correct. It has been shown that administration of aspirin by fighting the inflammatory response created by an accumulation of senescent cells, which disrupt the intercellular communication, seems to increase the lifespan.
Wait a moment. Does aspirin interfere with
inflammatory response?
Just with inflammatory response. Like it doesn't touch the cells?
No. The inflammatory response. The point is that senescent cells usually also induce inflammatory response, which then disrupts the intercellular communication. So the hallmarks are interconnected with each other. But if we talk about inflammation and intercellular communication, aspirin, it's an anti-inflammatory, so that's what it does. And it has been shown that in mice, it increases their lifespan.
Right, so if you want to interfere with your own altered intercellular communication by stuffing yourself with aspirin, don't. That's probably a really bad idea.
No.
So I lost.
Unfortunately, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to.
Well, it's fair enough.
Okay, fair enough.
Thus far, none of us has managed to win a trivia episode.
Not yet. Thank you very much for watching this video, if you watched it until the end. Otherwise, I could say whatever, you're already close to it. But yeah. And see you next time with the next videos, next trivia. Have a good day.
Remember to like, comment, and subscribe.
If you want.
If you don't want, we're not going to force you.
Exactly. Bye.